Good evening and welcome to Lightning Talks. I'm Jim Wharton. My pronouns are he and him. I'm the Vice President for Conservation Engagement and Learning here at the Aquarium. Now, Lightning Talks comes to you live from the Seattle Aquarium on the shores of Puget Sound in the contemporary and traditional territories of the Coast Salish people. And we want to thank you for joining us from wherever you call home. Now, our featured creatures this evening are brainless, heartless, and spineless. And while that may sound like some people you know, tonight we're talking about jellies. Now, jellies are some of the most fascinating creatures in the ocean. They're so simple and yet so successful. And the ocean is filled with gelatinous wonders. And more than just the animals that we know of as sort of jellyfish, there's also salps and siphonophores, comb jellies, and more. Now, the group includes some of the largest animals on Earth and some of the oldest. There are jellies that glow, that sting, that have creatures that live under their bell. There's at least one species of jelly that may be immortal. And we're just now learning more about how jellies factor into the way carbon moves through the ocean. Now, as usual, we have five great speakers this evening to tell us even more. Now, if you've never been to a Lightning Talk event before, this is what you have in store. Five speakers have 5 minutes each to share one big idea and not 1 second more. They'll get a warning at 1 minute. They'll get another warning at 30 seconds. And then finally, their last warning comes at time. And if they go over, they get this. Now, if you've been to Lightning Talks before, you know that we like to keep things moving over the course of the evening. So we won't be pausing for questions in between speakers, but we do have time for questions planned at the end of the evening. So please do put your questions into the chat, share your comments, and at the end of the evening, we'll have all of our speakers back to the screen for a Q&A conversation. Now, if you enjoy what you see tonight and you'd like to support the Seattle Aquarium, please do consider a donation. When you donate to the Seattle Aquarium, you're joining us in our mission to inspire conservation of our marine environment. And now we have a fantastic show this evening, and I'm really excited to get started. So please join me in welcoming our first speaker, Rebecca Helm. Now, Rebecca is a Lightning Talks veteran, and she's fascinated about how organisms change through time, especially jellies. Rebecca is a researcher and an assistant professor at Georgetown University. Rebecca, are you ready to lead us off?
Yes, thank you. Let me just pull my slides up really fast, and I'm happy to get started. Okay, let me know when you can see.
All right. Almost there. Looks great. Take it
away. Thanks for having me. All right, 5 minutes. So I have a story to tell y'all about jellyfish, a mystery that has persisted with humankind for as long as we have been looking at the ocean. Humans and jellyfish have lived together for thousands of years, and jellyfish are in our myths and legends and very old antiquated histories. Jellyfish were discussed by the Romans and the Greeks. In Japan, one of the oldest legends for how the islands formed is by this aggregation of jellyfish so huge that all the jellyfish turned to stone. So we have known about jellyfish for a very long time, but what we haven't been so sure of is where they come from. The first breakthrough in understanding where jellyfish come from, not that long ago. So in 1758, Carl Linnaeus described the first jellyfish species known as the moon jellyfish, Aurelia aurita. Now, Carl Linnaeus named all kinds of life on Earth. In fact, he's the person responsible for all the scientific names we have today, including names like Homo sapiens, which is us. So as he was describing life on Earth and coming up with this new way of talking about nature, it enabled different scientists to talk to each other. So, for example, in many Romance languages, jellyfish are called medusae, a word that scientists still use today. But in some languages, they are called very different things. One of my favorite is in Danish. They're called, I think, water humans. So really cool, diverse ways of talking about jellies complicate our science. Now, after the first jellyfish was described, another man named Michael Sars described these cute little animals that look a bit like sea anemones. You can see one right here that he called Skyphistema. That's the scientific name. Now, they're about the size of breadcrumbs and they live under shells and rocks, very unassuming little creatures. And along with the Skyphistema, he noticed there were these little segmented animals that looked like pine cones, and he gave them the scientific name Strobila. And you can see two little pine coney animals here. Around the same time, a different guy in a totally different part of the world discovered these little snowflake-shaped jellyfish that he gave the scientific name to called Ephyra. So these little snowflake jellies float around in the open ocean, beautiful, strange little creatures. But if your spidey senses are tingling that something's not quite right with all of these different animals, then you'd be correct to be suspicious. Because in 1835, several years after these three different species were described, Michael Sars discovered something extraordinary. After watching a Skyphistema for a long time, he realized that these animals, under certain conditions, transform into those pine cone animals that he named the Strobila, in a process we now call strobilation, the process of going from a Skyphistema, or polyp as we call them, into one of these little strobila-shaped pine cones. And if you look right at the top of that animal, you'll notice that one of those pine cones looks like a tiny Ephyra. And in fact, this is where jellyfish come from. Jellyfish aren't so much born as they are transformed. Polyps or Skyphistema live in nature all year round. Some of the oldest Skyphistema I have are about 100 years old. And every year, like trees, they will flower tiny jellyfish. The Skyphistema will then reform in a smaller body and start the life cycle anew. So from four species, we are down to one. We have a Medusa, a Skyphistema or polyp, a Strobila, and an Ephyra. Now, why did it take so long for humans to crack this mystery? Well, I think it has a little bit to do with our own biology. We have what's called a simple life cycle. So you start as little babies with 10 fingers and 10 toes and a mouth and a nose. And when you're an adult, you have the same mouth and the same nose and those same fingers and toes. But for most animals, that's not the case. Complex life cycles are quite common in the animal kingdom. Some of the ones we know include caterpillars and butterflies or tadpoles and frogs. But the most complicated life cycle among free living organisms, I would argue, belongs to the jellies, including things like jellyfish. So among animals, jellies have this incredibly beautiful complex life cycle. And this complex life cycle now allows us to do so much of the science on jellies that you'll be learning more about today. So it's been my absolute pleasure to introduce these amazing animals, and I look forward to learning more from our other speakers about jellyfish science in the world right now. So thank you so much for having me. And I think I'm under time.
You're pretty close to under time. So Rebecca, when you think about that life cycle, one of the things that came to mind is, when does a jelly's life begin and end?
Good question. Every Ephyra that pops off a Strobila is identical. And so one single Skyphistema or polyp can make thousands of jellyfish. You could start the life of a Medusa or jellyfish when it pops off that Strobila or pine cone shape. And then it ends when the jellyfish dies. But really, it's those Skyphistema that give origin to all of these things, and they can live for a very long time. So it's quite a complicated answer to what should be a relatively simple question.
That's super interesting. And I'm going to guess that that's probably spawning more questions in our audience. If you have those questions, please do put those into the chat. And then Rebecca will join us at the end of the evening for that Q&A conversation. Rebecca, thank you so much. Our next speaker is Ren Shelton. Ren is an aquarist who rears and raises jellies here at the Seattle Aquarium. Now, she has experience with more than a dozen different species, and tonight she'll share more about what it takes to care for an animal who happens to be almost entirely comprised of water. Ren, are you ready to go?
All set.
Slides look great. Take it away.
All right. So today I wanted to talk about what it takes to take care of jellies. Next slide. As someone who loves eating, I thought we would start with feeding. So one of my favorite things about jellies is how diverse they are. And that leads to a full spectrum of diets. So most jellies, like moons, are satisfied with a basic brine shrimp meal plan. And brine shrimp are pink, and so when the jellies are full, their stomachs actually turn pink, which is a very useful jelly husbandry tool. Then we have, for comparison, on the bottom right, a picture of a moon jelly who has not eaten recently, and its stomach is white, so you can tell the difference. Next, we have spotted lagoon jellies who will not thrive if they are not also fed rotifers. So rotifers are about half the size of a brine shrimp nauplii and definitely trickier to culture or to grow. The flower hat jelly requires you to hand feed them a single fish multiple times a day to be happy. And if you give them a frozen or a dead fish, they can tell the difference and they will not eat it and rather starve. They also have a very nasty sting, so in order to feed them, we would shoot the fish down a long feeding tube to target feed the animals. So it definitely requires some coordination. And then lastly, I've highlighted egg yolk jellies because these guys are at the top of the jelly food chain. And just like carnivores, they have a fancy name, medusivore, because they eat other jellies, such as moon jellies, which are at the bottom of the jelly food chain. All right, next slide. So we fed the jellies, but jellies come from polyps, and so taking care of jellies also means taking care of the polyps. This might be one of my favorite parts of jelly husbandry because it feels like tending to the smallest garden. It actually fits into your palm. And the tools that I use are a microscope because it is that tiny, very fine tip paintbrushes, dental tools, and tweezers. And we clean the petri dishes that the polyps grow on to help eliminate pest species that might outcompete our polyps for space and food. And it's also a good opportunity to get a close-up look to gauge how the polyps are feeding, if there's any strobilation events, asexual reproduction methods, or other weird things that polyps do. For instance, next slide. This is what you might see looking at some moon jelly polyps. So in the first shot, we've got various stages of strobilation. And in the second one, you can kind of see different body conditions of the polyps, some that are feeding better, some that are reproducing, and things like that. Next slide. All right, so not only do we care for the jellies and the polyps, but we also regularly rear new generations of jellies from those polyps. So this is a true investment and a labor of love, and it really makes you appreciate the morphological changes that they have to go through to make it to adulthood. So just to give you a sense of the timeline, I last probed my polyps to make new jellies in mid-December. I started getting Ephyra, the little flower-like things, 2 weeks later. I spent a week collecting those, and then 3 to 4 weeks later, they started to bell out, which means they started to look less like a little flower and more like a tiny jelly. About 2.5 months later, after they were little flowers, they looked more like adult jellies ready to be on display. So mid-December, I had started, and late March, those animals were going on to exhibit, where they still are, and as this generation reaches the end of life, I will start to plan for the next generation. So lots of forethought and good timing. And none of that is to mention the fragility of those early stages and how essential and finicky things like water flow, nutrition, and population density are. For instance, if jellies are too crowded in a tank, it actually stunts their growth. Next slide. Okay, it's just getting weirder because you can actually exercise your jellies. This is a brown rim moon jelly, and they're very, very delicate. And I once worked at a facility where we adjusted the water flow for a couple hours a day to make them pulse more,
with the thought that by working those muscles instead of floating like a sail on the wind, it would help reinforce their bells and they would be less likely to deform. Next slide. So to sum it up, jellies are wacky and diverse, and caring for them is also wacky and diverse. And here are just a few photos I've taken from under the scope of some moon jelly polyps displaying crazy methods of reproduction.
Well, thank you, Ren. That was amazing. I'm taken by the idea that jellies are, we always think about jellies as being very simple, and yet caring for them seems quite complex. There's a lot of variability in what they'll eat and what they won't eat. For an animal without a brain, they seem awfully picky about what they will or won't eat. Do you see a lot of variability between the species that you care for, or was it really the ones that you just highlighted tonight?
Yeah, absolutely a lot of variability. Just given that some of them hang out at the top of the water column, some of them are in the middle, some are even on the substrate itself. So they have a lot of different needs and different kinds of things like water flow that they're looking for. So yeah, it's really a different game for every kind of jelly.
That's amazing. So Ren is going to come back again for Q&A later. So if you have questions about what it takes to raise jellies in our care, or what it takes for a jelly to make it through its life cycle, please do put those questions into the chat. Ren, we'll see you soon. Our next speaker is MacKenzie Bubel. MacKenzie is a senior aquarist at the Monterey Bay Aquarium. And MacKenzie's going to share with us what it's like to collect and rear a brand new species of ocean jelly in human care. Now, these animals are so delicate and so mysterious that it sometimes takes innovative new technologies to provide the care they require. MacKenzie, are you ready to tell us more?
I sure hope so. Okay, can All right. you see my slides?
Slides look great. Take it away.
Okay, awesome. So everybody, hello. Let's go ahead and talk about these jellies known as long, stingy, stringy thingies. Another name they go by is the siphonophore. So working at a public aquarium, I consider my main job is to expose visitors to the diversity of animals on planet Earth. It's really my hope that they can build empathy for these animals and feel more connected to the ocean, thus helping us all conserve the ocean. As Ren did a great job alluding to, though, it's being a jellyfish aquarist, you not only are a scientist, but you actually have to be a bit of a jellyfish farmer, too, because to reliably fill a huge public aquarium, you need to have your schedule and grow your jellies up constantly throughout the year. A couple of years ago, the jelly team and I at the Monterey Bay Aquarium had a really big goal in mind, and it's to display these ultra-delicate pelagic jellies called comb jellies, and they have a totally different life cycle than what we've been hearing about from Dr. Helm and Ren with the polyp phase. So we invented this special tank we call the diffusion tube. You can see it kind of highlighted under a blue light over on the left there. And, you know, I would love to go into it, but this is a lightning talk. We don't have a ton of time, but if you're interested, we did write a paper about it, and feel free to click the link in the chat or just Google diffusion tubes and culture if you'd like to see more about it. Because of the pelagic and delicate nature of comb jellies, luckily for us, all these rearing tubes also worked for the deep sea siphonophore that we're now culturing for our display into our Into the Deep gallery. Siphonophores are so cool, guys. Check this out. They are really complex marine organisms that are considered colonial organisms. They start by a single fertilized embryo, and then they asexually bud off all these genetically identical and physiologically integrated different bodies. So they're one of the longest animals in the ocean. They've been clocked at 40 meters long, and they also are voracious predators. So they can extend their fiery tentacles out that 40 meters and sting their prey and reel them into all their different stomachs. You can see all lined up, all those little dots right there. Here is a 1 week old tiny, tiny baby siphonophore under the microscope in the jelly lab. You can already kind of see some of those complex specialized bodies forming. You can see the gas float or the nematophore that it uses to orient itself in the ocean. and also those stinging cells, that fiery death net that I was talking about under the microscope. If you look really closely, you can actually see those little harpoons firing off, trying to sting even just the water in this little dish. And look at this, we put it under specific lighting conditions and we learned that they fluoresce too. There's a teaser for you. So none of this could be possible without collaboration between academia and public aquaria. We're really lucky in Monterey to have the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute in our back pocket and in the front of our minds, because they let us borrow their huge ocean-going vessels where we brave the massive icy waters of Monterey Bay. We deploy these remotely operated vehicles you see up in the left there so that we can actually enter this deep sea environment, go down 375 meters to as gently as possible collect these adult wild siphonophore specimens you see on the right. And then we, as gently as possible, take them all the way back to the lab and place them in these innovative rearing tanks that I was discussing earlier. Once they're in the lab, we take all the care we can to collect their microscopic planula or their tiny little babies and use our resources to grow them up. And basically, I really sincerely hope all this effort's worth it. I love doing it, but for two reasons. The first, I hope that displaying a deep sea siphonophore that's less commonly known really helps people be curious about the world around them. But secondly, I actually really hope that we can leverage science with these culture methods, because as I've alluded to, it's very difficult to collect these animals. And so the people that are asking the big questions about what is life on this planet, how is it organized in such an interesting way, don't have access to the animals. So hopefully one day I would be able to provide these animals to researchers so that we can further science, even though we're just a public aquarium. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you so much, MacKenzie. I love the idea of these. Like you, when you go down in the ROV or submersible or anything, it feels like you're going into a totally different world and you're bringing back aliens. Is that like when they go down and they collect things, do they sometimes come back with stuff that you just don't know what it is?
Almost every time. I've been so lucky to go on many expeditions. And even with the people that have been looking with these remotely operated vehicles for 25 years, there's always something no one recognizes. So it's just so thrilling to me to be able to bring that to the public.
Yeah, what a moment to be a part of. That's amazing.
Love it.
Well, thank you, MacKenzie. If you have questions about MacKenzie's talk or any of the talks this evening, don't forget to put those into the chat. MacKenzie, there's some good stuff in the chat. You might want to check it out.
Sweet.
Now, our next speaker is Mike Stukel. Mike is an associate professor at Florida State University that studies how some of the smallest organisms in the ocean can influence major ocean and ecological systems. Now, this evening, Mike is going to introduce us to a completely different kind of gelatinous critter. Mike, are you ready to tell us more about salps?
Thanks, Jim. It's my great pleasure to talk about salps. So the organisms that you see going through here are a group called the salps. They vary in size from about an inch to about a foot long. We sometimes call them the ocean vacuum cleaner because they're organisms that ecologically play a very different role than other gelatinous organisms. They actually filter the ocean, removing a lot of algae from the ocean. Salps, like the other jellies that have been talked about today, are mostly clear. They're mostly water. If you bump into them in the water, you would probably mistake them for a jellyfish. But really, they're actually much more closely related to us than they are to other jellyfish. So what I'm showing you now is really the animal tree of life. On the very right side over there, you see cnidaria, which is the other jellyfish that we've talked about today. On the left side, you see vertebrata, which includes, of course, us, and right next to it, tunicates, which includes salps. So salps are actually much more closely related to you than they are to other jellyfish or even any of the other plankton in the ocean. Salps, when you get down to it ecologically, they're really big, clear, prey concentrating machines. They have muscle bands that run around their body, and they pump those muscles constantly, just pushing water through themselves. They create a feeding current that draws their prey, which are tiny algae, through their bodies and then they catch them on a very fine meshed filter. And then they actually concentrate those prey into fecal pellets, which then sink to the bottom of the ocean and actually serve as food for deep sea organisms. And the salps themselves will often fall and sink to the bottom of the ocean where they'll feed these deep ocean organisms. So salps are really important for supplying food to the organisms that live on the bottom of the ocean. Another thing that's really important about salps is that those fine mesh filters that they have inside them are really, really small. And that allows them to feed on the tiniest organisms that live on the ocean. And in fact, salps have one of the highest predator to prey size ratios of any organism in the ocean. This chart here from one of my grad students' papers actually shows the predator to prey size ratio. So the difference between a predator and an organism that it eats. For salps, which are all of the colored dots on the right side of this figure, and then a whole host of other different types of organisms on the left. So I want to just show you where some of these other organisms are. So on the right side, we have salps, which feed at a predator to prey size ratio of between 1,000 to 1 and 10,000 to 1. In the middle of the graph, we have krill, which feed at a predator to prey size ratio of about 100 to 1. And on the left-hand side, we have some of the other jellyfish, which tend to feed at a predator to prey size ratio of 1 to 1 or 10 to 1. And I know many of you don't think about predator to prey size ratio, so I want to really put this in perspective by thinking about what such a predator to prey size ratio would be for a lion. So a lion feeding on a gazelle would have a predator to prey size ratio of about 1 to 1. A lion feeding on a rabbit would be about 10 to 1. So this is sort of the range that most jellyfish are. Those krill at about 100 to 1, that's like a lion feeding on a grasshopper. That 1,000 to 1 predator to prey size ratio, that's a lion feeding on a flea. And a 10,000 to 1 predator to prey size ratio is a lion feeding on a little tiny microscopic amoeba. So these salps are like the equivalent of a lion feeding on either a flea or an amoeba. And that's really important because here on land, we think of our primary producers as being things like, you know, trees. But in the ocean, most of the primary producers are microscopic. They're little tiny algae that are so small that you can fit 1,000 of them in a row. And that row of 1,000 algae would only be the width of a dime. So when you have salps in the ocean, they're able to feed on these little tiny things. And so you have large organisms that are able to be the herbivores of the ocean. Salps also have really complex life cycles and explosive population growth rates. Salps give birth, they have a solitary asexual generation and a sexual colonial forming generation. This allows them to form huge blooms. So a single salp can rapidly give birth to a huge amount of organisms that can absolutely fill the ocean with these taxa. And that's really important because those salp fecal pellets also contribute a lot to carbon export. So when you have a bloom of salps taking over the ocean, they can actually increase the amount of carbon sequestered by the ocean by a factor of between 2 and 10. So if we have huge blooms of salps, this leads to a huge amount of carbon sequestration in the deep ocean and helps us to fight climate change.
Oh, so yeah, I thought you had one more sentence, and if you had spoken one more sentence, you would definitely would have gotten the lightning. But well done,
that's amazing. I stopped because I feared the lightning.
You don't have to fear the lightning. The I'm still like my mind is still spinning on the predator to prey ratio. So is it? Am I right then also that a salp is larger than its prey, than a blue whale is larger than their prey?
Yeah, the ratio between a salp and its prey is slightly larger than the ratio between a blue whale and the krill that it feeds on.
Yeah, that's wild. I mean, it's hard to appreciate. I love your example of the lion because I think we feel much more comfortable understanding the scale of things on land, and the scale of organisms and systems in the ocean almost feels like incomprehensible. It's really unbelievable.
Yeah, it's incredible the differences between different sizes as you go through all of these organisms that are all part of the plankton.
Good stuff. Thank you so much, Mike. Mike will be back in just a bit for questions, so please do put them in the chat. I've been seeing a ton of questions coming through, so I know that we're going to have a really good conversation. Thanks again, Mike. I can't believe that we're already to our final speaker of the evening, but we are, and it's Anna Klompen. Anna is a fellow and postdoctoral researcher with the Stowers Institute for Medical Research. Anna studies jelly venom. For our last presentation of the evening, Anna asked, could a jelly sting you without even touching you? Anna, are you ready to bring us home?
I think so.
All right, looks great, take it away.
All right, cool. Well, I hope all of you has been as excited as I am. I love talking about jellies and hearing about jellies. And now I'm gonna tell you a little bit about what's really driven me as a scientist, and that's been the jellyfish sting. So what you're looking at right here is a jellyfish sting. Now in reality, this is actually a sea anemone tentacle, but they're close cousins. And this is pretty close to what it would look like in a jellyfish too. And if you look at those arrows and maybe watch some of those little pinpoints, you might see the little capsules and threads popping in and out. So that's what the sting of a jellyfish looks like. All those little capsules are called little stinging cell structures. And what those are doing is firing off, and then those long thread-like things you're seeing out there are injecting a very complex cocktail of toxins called venom. So what are jellyfish using their stings for? So here's some polyps that we've been hearing a little bit about. So polyps also sting as well. So for the most part, jellies are stinging in order to capture prey. And they're using that venom to really help them incapacitate prey that might be fast moving, especially if they're not moving, like polyps here. But it also, the venom that they use from those stings can also help deter predators that might be much larger or faster moving than they are. So this complex mixture of toxins can cause, if you've been stung by a jellyfish, you might know, can be quite painful. They often cause prey to be paralyzed, and they also allow for the animals to start digesting things as well. So, and if you've been stung by a jellyfish, or you've looked at cartoons that have been like, you're almost like electrified or feel a burning sensation, you're not being electrified or have a burn or being burned in a way, you are getting stung and all these toxins are going into your body and causing this pain. So how are they delivering these things? What does the actual, those structures look like up close? So here is an actual stinging cell really close up. There's an unfired at the bottom and the same one fired at the top. So you can see that it has this really cool spine structure, the spine shaft at the top. So that can help jellyfish really puncture through any prey that have really hard parts on them, like crabs, or those brine shrimp we talked about. Then you see that super long tubule thread-like structure. So that's actually hollow, and that pushes this mixture of toxins, this venom, into the other animal so that they're able to get stung. And so when you get stung by a jellyfish, you might have hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands of these stinging cells are actually injecting all at the same time. So that must mean that they're very small, and these are in fact very small. So this particular stinging cell, if you stacked 5 to 10 of them on top of each other, be about the same thickness as a sheet of printer paper. So these stinging cells really act by making contact with either prey or predators. So the answer should be simple, right? Don't touch a jellyfish, including if they look dead on the beach, and it won't hurt you, right? So turns out that's not exactly true. And this is something a team and I found out when we were looking at these little jellies just a few years ago. So these are upside down jellyfish, aptly named, I think. And these can be found all over the world in shallow, warm water areas. And they can get the size of the palm of my hand, if not even bigger. And they're very common, in fact, in places where people like to snorkel. So let's imagine you're snorkeling over a lawn of hundreds of these jellies here, but you're being good. You're not gonna touch them, right? But you might kick them up a little bit as you're kind of swimming about. Well, what these jellies tend to do as a response to being disturbed is they actually make a ton of goo. So this is a bowl of these jellies that I've had that we sprayed water on, and they've turned it essentially all into mucousy snot. So it happened to be, if you were going over these and you got some of the snot on you, but you didn't touch the jellyfish, you still come out with a little bit of an itch, maybe a little bit of a rash, or if you're particularly sensitive, a really kind of burning, really bad irritation on your skin. This is called stinging water. And for a long time, we didn't know why this was happening. So we looked carefully at this snot. We started seeing these weird bumpy-like structures. So we looked a little closer. And these weird popcornish bumpy-like structures got even weirder. There's hundreds of them. And when we looked really close, they're made by hundreds of stinging cells. They move around. They're completely independent of the jellyfish. They're full of this mucus. You run into them and they can fire, completely independent of the jelly. So what you're gonna see is a video. I'm gonna throw some brine shrimp on there. These are moving in real time, stings without touching. So try to avoid touching a jellyfish if you can, but know that there's some that have fooled you in some ways and can sting you without touching you.
So Anna, thank you so much. So I remember we used to, at Moat Marine Laboratory, to take kids in the water, moats in Sarasota, Florida. So there are lots of upside down jellies in the area. And every once in a while, the kids would just start freaking out like they were stung. And we used to think it was because maybe it was a detached tentacle. It had just been torn off a jelly. It was floating through the water. Is it possible it was the stinging snot instead?
So I think that's pretty possible. If these, especially these, were in the area, they release tons of mucus like that. And these, weirdly, the jellyfish, at least from my experience, you can almost touch these and it's not going to feel good. And I don't recommend it, but it doesn't feel that bad. I've stuck my hand in mucus water of these and it hurts. So maybe it's not usually that bad, but maybe.
Yeah. All right. Well, this time, Anna's not going anywhere. We're going to bring all of our speakers back to the stage and have our Q&A conversation. So if you haven't had a chance to yet, please do put your questions into the chat. We've got a ton of questions, and I hope we can get to many of them, but I don't think we'll get to all of them. So much good, so many good ideas, and so much curiosity has been spurred. But I wonder, do you all have any questions for each other before we get started?
I'm wondering for MacKenzie, what your favorite thing that your ROV has brought up that you've seen.
Ren, it's so hard to pick.
I'm sure.
Yeah. So because my jellyfish journey kind of started with comb jellies, and now it's evolved into siphonophores as a real passion to try to figure them out. But I'm pretty in love with Lampetius corundiventer, the bloody belly comb jelly. And even though we currently display them, and so I've had the opportunity to collect them very often, but it's still just, it's so exciting to bring them into the sunlight and see that bright red color shining, and a challenge to transfer them since they're even the most delicate comb jelly I've ever worked with.
And MacKenzie, when you all, I mean, you sort of alluded to this, but it's not like you drag a net through the deep sea to pick up jellies. How do you get a gelatinous creature like that to the surface?
Right. I couldn't explain it all in 5 minutes, but basically the remotely operated vehicle we're allowed to borrow, you know, for our collections, it's, in lack of a better word, a huge science robot that has these eight, they're called detritus samplers. Think of like a big cylinder with hydraulically shutting doors on the top and bottom. And so these expert pilots, they make it look so easy. It is not easy. They'll position in the currents and stuff in the deep sea around an animal and slowly descend around it and shut the doors, thus kind of taking all the water and the jelly with us to the surface when we've filled up.
That's amazing. So yeah. It's not like a vacuum, because I think that's what people would think, you know, like we'll just slurp it up. But no, they just drift over it and basically close the doors on it.
Yeah, actually, I decline to say, but there is a vacuum too. There's like the most delicate way, which is the detritus samplers. And then we actually do, it's literally a suction by a pump. It's a vacuum with a funnel attached to the top, a 3-inch funnel. And we can turn the pump on and slurp down this corrugated tubing into other kind of canisters. But that's for the ones that can handle that.
For the more durable jellies.
The more durable jellies, yeah.
So there's a ton of questions in the chat, and a lot of them are sort of fascinated by the jelly life cycle and the other sort of pieces of the puzzle, right? So we got a chance to talk to some of them. We couldn't talk about it all. And there's a lot of interest in how jellies grow. I mean, obviously they're animals, so they eat things, and then eating things allows them to grow. But I alluded to it in the introduction. There are some jellies that people describe as kind of like immortal. Like, what does that mean? Like, why do some people think that about certain species of jellies? I don't know, Rebecca, if you want to jump on that, if anyone wants to jump in.
Sure. Yeah. So jellyfish can do something that we haven't observed in any other animal. When you take certain species of jelly, like Turritopsis dornii, this cute little jelly called the immortal jelly, and you take the medusa and you stab it a lot. So it's very mortally injured. It should die. And it crinkles into a little ball that looks like a little folded tissue paper and falls to the bottom of the ocean. And then this weird thing happens where it doesn't die. A little strand grows out that looks almost like the root of a tree. And from that, a new polyp is born. So it can essentially go back in time. It would be a bit like if you smushed a butterfly and a little caterpillar crawled out. So that is very cool and really unusual. And it's led a lot of people to assume that they're immortal because they can kind of Benjamin Button their way out of a bad situation. The philosophical challenge with that is that in order to determine if something's immortal, you kind of have to be immortal yourself. You have to be able to watch life for a really long time. So for example, we used to think that a lot of grasses were immortal because we know that a patch of grass can live for thousands of years. But if you take that old patch of grass and plant it next to a new patch of grass, it turns out it's a lot more fragile than that new baby patch. So even though it can live a really long time, it still seems to age. It just ages very slowly. So are these really immortal jellyfish? We're not quite sure, but maybe come back in 1,000 years, we might have a good idea.
I'll circle back around for that one. Ren, we talked a lot about the life cycle. Rebecca went through it and you talked about it a little bit. And I think we had this vision of the polyps that sort of strobulate and then flake off. But how does it get back around to the rest of the life cycle? You have the medusa. How do you get back to polyps?
Yeah. So essentially, all of the medusa have gonads. And so they can broadcast spawn, and those gonads can meet each other and then create new polyps. The reason that we generally don't do it in the aquarium is because it takes a lot longer because you're starting further down the track. So when looking towards like displaying animals and such, we often go from the polyp stage, or we share polyps with each other and trade them and things like that. But yes, the medusa can reproduce. They all have gonads and they can broadcast spawn to create more polyps.
So MacKenzie or Ren, do we all ever have salps in aquariums?
I've collected some salps. I don't even want to tell Mike this, but it was basically for amphipods that carved them into homes.
I love those amphipods. They're so interesting.
I know. I do too.
They're just making great little homes for their babies.
They're just loving mothers that are just
That's what I say every time.
Yeah. But beyond that, I've tried before with doleolids, and I couldn't give them enough algae. It was, I loved your reference to how many, fleas would a lion need to eat to stay alive. It's just like beyond the capacity of what I could grow at the aquarium,
They're voracious predators.
Yeah, I love that idea that the salp is an absolutely voracious predator that's feeding on so much. And someone else was asking about like salp blooms. And some people know, we've talked about this in other contexts, like that some of the things that eat jellies, ocean sunfish, turtles, sea turtles. Do sea turtles like salps? And if so, like, is there a nutritional difference between some species of jellies and salps?
So salps are actually very nutritious, and leatherback turtles feed on salps a lot. And having blooms of salps is actually really good for the sea turtles because basically in order to get those tiny algae all the way up to jellyfish for the sea turtle to feed on, that's many, many different trophic steps. So you lose energy at each trophic step. But salps, because they can feed on the smallest things in the ocean, is just one trophic step away. So it's the presence of salps is basically a very efficient way to get food naturally up to sea turtles.
So these big salp blooms are a good thing. I've also heard, we've also heard talk about jelly epidemics and, like, you know, giant blooms of jellies, and jellies are taking over the ocean. And in 2050, there'll be nothing but jellies and no fish. Like, what's going on with that? Is that just sort of alarmist nonsense from the internet? Are there more jellies, less jellies? What's going on? Whoever wants to grab that can grab that.
I think it's a little bit of scary and a little bit of true. So in some parts of the ocean, particularly places close to big cities or rivers that are dumping a lot of pollutants, you see that a lot of animals can't really live in those areas, but certain species of jellyfish can. And so it sometimes looks like there are a lot of jellyfish in part because there's so much other stuff missing. But in reality, a lot of the jellyfish biologists that I know that have been following their local diverse jellyfish populations for many decades say that the jellyfish are also decreasing, like many of the other animals. And it's only this small handful of jellies, like moon jellies, that seem to be doing pretty well. So I am definitely cheering for a bit of a jellyfish apocalypse. It would be great job security for me and all of my students. But I hate to disappoint, it doesn't really look like that's going to happen. Jellies, like other ocean animals, are affected by the same changing waters. And we see in most cases, they're not doing super great. But I will definitely turn it over to my colleagues here for more answers to that.
So we can't be expecting our gelatinous overlords anytime soon.
They wish.
I keep my fingers crossed, but no.
I feel like I get that question a lot too. Maybe it is a fantastical thing to think about, like, oh, jellies can evolve so quickly. They're going to take over the sea. But just in my very tiny world I live in, where we go out in Monterey Bay, you know, it depends on the water temperature a lot of times. And so species we're used to seeing, if the water's 5 degrees Fahrenheit different, they're not going to be there and they have to live farther north. So I think they're just as, sensitive to all the changes as everything else. I don't know. It's a really big question, but.
Yeah. So show of hands, how many people here have been stung by a jelly?
Today.
So, like, that's one of the things that people associate with jellies, right? They're scared of jellies because they're worried about being stung, and they've heard about man o' wars and how terrible that would be, and the awful things you have to do to people when they get stung, and box jellies and how poisonous those are. Like, Anna, how many jellies are actually dangerously venomous?
All jellies are venomous. So I will say all jellies can sting you, but not all jellies sting, but not all of them can really hurt you. And it's actually a very small number that are either large enough to actually get through your skin. So those stinging cells are quite small. They vary in size. The bigger the jelly, often bigger the stinging cells. So those can hurt you, but very, very few can truly cause a problem to you. I don't have a rough estimate of numbers, but
yeah,
for the most part, it's easy to know where you're going. You're only kind of limited to a few species.
Yeah. And that difficulty of getting through the skin, that's sort of the basis for lifeguards in Australia wearing like pantyhose and that kind of stuff to try to just increase that distance so that they're not vulnerable to the sting.
Exactly. And I think it's been found like even just pantyhose for the most part protects you from the vast majority of species, a light layer of clothing.
Mm-hmm. All right. So here's the showstopper. Ren, I'm going to land this with you and feel free to weigh in if y'all are curious. We've had a lot of interest to understand, do jellyfish have butts?
What a great question. So jellyfish are kind of, they have all their systems that maybe have multiple functions. And so being a more simple system, their mouth is also their butt. So Yeah, they will take in their food the same way they dispose of it. And that's the life of a jelly.
I don't think that's good news. But it just, you know, it kind of reinforces how strange, you know, some of these animals are. But Mike, you know, the salps, not the same, right? The salps are a different kind of animal.
Salps are closely related to us. They have mouths and butts just like we do. And in fact, salp poop is actually important to the global carbon cycle.
So tell me more about that. So when we're talking about global carbon cycle, we're talking about, you know, how we're talking about everything from emissions to, you know, animals and their waste products. And all of that is carbon. All of that's related to, you know, how our climate functions. How does salps come into this?
So when we are emitting carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, a lot of the carbon dioxide that we produce actually goes into the surface ocean. And into the surface ocean, it can be taken up by algae in the same way that it can be taken up by trees. But unlike trees, which only which will live 100 years and store that carbon, algae only live about a week. So they don't store carbon for very long. But if salps eat those algae, salps then will poop out a lot of the carbon from the algae, and that the carbon in their fecal pellets actually gets transported down into the deep ocean and even into the sediments, where it can be stored for thousands of years. So the salps actually play a big role in removing carbon dioxide from the atmosphere.
So it's amazing that how complex these systems are, and like these animals that seem so unassuming can have these really critical roles. It's not all about us. There's a lot of other stuff going on out there. That's like salps are, I'm not sure they would have been first on my list of thinking about, you know, real drivers and controllers of the carbon cycle. So MacKenzie, someone has a question here about, you know, Monterey sometimes has ocean sunfish, which are amazing. And of course they eat jellies in the wild. Do y'all feed it? Will you feed those animals jellies?
Oh, that's a great question. I think if we wanted a huge moon jelly tank that the mola mola, the ocean sunfish lived in, we could, because moon jellies can thrive in basically any system. So I would get sternly reprimanded by my coworkers if I put a moon jelly anywhere near this big tank that we house the mola mola in. Ren knows how successful moon jelly polyps can be, I'm sure, at infiltrating. But we actually, there's some brilliant aquarists that have worked on the nutritional content of Aralia species that, and like hydrozones and stuff that the mola mola would eat. And we've created, it's actually a special sausage, for lack of a better word, that has kind of that water content and some of the nutrients that could replicate a moon jelly. It also is really funny to watch them and feed them. It's just a full sausage of kind of jelly-like material with extra vitamins is how we get away with not feeding them jellies.
I love the idea of a jelly sausage that you feed to the to the ocean sunfish. That's incredible.
We literally blend it up in a blender and use sausage casing, the vegetarian kind, pour it through a funnel and make more of a sausage.
Available at a Whole Foods near you.
Delicious.
So Ren, we have some questions about whether we'll have jellies or different species of jellies in the new Ocean Pavilion, which for folks that don't know, we're the Seattle Aquarium is currently in construction of a new exhibit called the Ocean Pavilion that features ecosystems that are found in the coral triangles, tropical ecosystems. So there's some curiosity, will we have jellies in the new exhibit?
Yeah, absolutely. It's going to be a really cool exhibit, and you might get a little bit more of a view of the whole process of jelly life cycles. And it hasn't been totally decided yet what species might appear. So we may have some new species showing up, and it might be sticking to more of the spotted lagoon jellies, but there will definitely be the added of getting to see more of that process of culturing jellies.
So I know that there's some places that have jelly touch tanks. So how does that work? Animal that's stinging is not generally something you want to touch.
I can at least throw a little bit of what I know, though the aquarist will know this a bit better. So those jelly touch tanks, so they limit those pretty well to just touching the top of the bell, so the top of them do. So there are stinging cells there, but in very low numbers. And so they're very unlikely to kind of go through there. And also, for whatever reason, at least anecdotally, I believe, jellyfish raised fully in aquaria don't seem to have as bad of a sting in some cases for some species than others. I don't think that's actually been well tested. That's something I'd love to do. Hint, hint for any of the aquarists in here. But that's possibly a little bit of how they can get away with it. It's mostly moon jellies, which are usually not too bad anyway. And they're homegrown, which seems to make them a little bit better.
I will add that it's not good to touch a jelly on the top if you see it in the wild, even if it's a moon jelly. Having personally made that mistake, I feel like that's just good to put in there. As I said.
Yeah, I would not touch a beached jelly or live jelly.
So you had talked about that, Anne, and maybe we just talk about that for a second, because I know that I've had experience with kids on the beach. And they see a jelly and it's kind of cool and gross. And I've seen kids jump on them and have bad consequences. Like, if it's dead, how is it stinging?
So when jellyfish make those stinging cells, so they're almost making them as a little self-contained package in a way. So those actual capsules with the venom and all that, they make that, they put those in their tentacles or other structures where they have them. And those kind of are in weight. So at that point, even if the jellyfish itself dies or that piece of tentacle comes off, that doesn't mean those sting cell capsules are still there. It's almost like a little present that it's left for you. And until it's discharged, it is able to discharge. So even if they're dead on the beach, any stinging cells that they've made beforehand and they make them constantly, be ready to go.
So basically it's a spring-loaded machine. And, I know that we've also told, people that you should, wash your hands with salt water afterwards if you ran any, ran into anything on the beach, because the fresh water will also trigger those stinging cells.
Yeah. So the two big issues when you get stung are typically, if you get stung by a jellyfish, there's some unfired either stinging cells on there, either in tentacle pieces or whatnot. So you want to try and get as many of those off without firing them as possible. Hence, very gentle salt water can help. And then the other issue is if you just actually got stung. So essentially that venom is in there. So something that a lot of people do is do hot water for a fairly long period of time. And that can sometimes help. And sometimes for most people in general, there's pain, but it goes away after a little while. So you can be allergic, though. So if anyone gets stung and you start having breathing issues, that's the time that you want to get help for sure.
All right. So I certainly don't want to end our night tonight talking about stings. So rapid fire, favorite jelly, Anna.
The red eye jelly.
Red eye jelly. Rebecca.
By the wind sailor jellies, which are washing up in California right now. Yes.
Love it. Ren.
Flower hat jellies.
Flower hat jellies. Love it. MacKenzie.
I love the bloody belly comb jelly so much.
Knew it. Knew it. Yeah. Mike.
I love salpa thompsoni and then also comb jellies.
Love it. And just to be fair, I kind of have a soft spot for lion's mane jellies because I got stung in the head by one once. And so I feel like we have a relationship. Well, that's all the time we have for this evening. Thanks again to our speakers. All of you were amazing. I could have had this conversation all night long. Please drop some applause emoji into the chat and show them some appreciation. Now, if you enjoyed tonight's free science event, please do consider a donation to keep programs like Lightning Talks free and accessible for all. Our next Lightning Talk event will be on July 19th, and we are excited to explore the world of, wait for it, snails. That's right. This is one of the most requested topics from you, the viewers. And if you have ideas for future Lightning Talk topics, please do send them our way. We'll have more information about our July 19th event announced soon, but don't miss out on catching lightning snails. Now, we're also excited to invite you to Splash Friday, June 2nd. Join the Seattle Aquarium for our biggest party of the year and our signature fundraising gala. Slip into your favorite resort wear, like shorts, sandals, swanky cocktail attire, and prepare for a fun night of amazing opportunities to experience the aquarium like the ultimate insider. Now you can see all of our past Lightning Talks events on our YouTube channel. And while you're there, you can check it out and make sure you click like and subscribe. Thank you all so much for joining us tonight. Have a great evening.